Good morning.
Good morning
and happy new year. This is our really first Sunday of the new year, and so it's wonderful to see all of you. We call it Epiphany Sunday, although Epiphany was actually yesterday, but we celebrate it today. Obviously, we have communion this morning, and the deacon offering for the month of January is going to Sister Jean's Kitchen. If you get the press, the Atlantic City Press, they had a front page article about the restart of Sister Jean's Kitchen in Atlantic City. And so we are glad to be of help to that for this month. On Monday, we have a grief group that meets at 4 o'clock. They weren't meeting during the holiday, so they are resuming. If any of you know of someone who lost a spouse and would like to be part of that group, they're a really friendly, nice group of people that come at 4 o'clock and share. On Tuesday at 9 o'clock, the Charity League will be here in the building. And then at 7 o'clock, the trustees will be meeting. It says 9 o'clock, nope, and it's not the wrong date either, because the trustees have to approve the budget. So please, trustees, try to be there at 7 o'clock on Tuesday evening. On Wednesday night at 6 o'clock, the Bell Choir meets. This is a great time to get started. We had a new person this past week, and we're starting new music, so great time to jump in and play some bells. And the Chancel Choir rehearses at 7 o'clock. On Thursday, the ladies' dinner out. It's at Sapore's Restaurant in Ventnor. It's a wonderful Italian place if you haven't already had food from there. Richard and I do takeout from there all the time because it's right on my way home, and I stop and pick it up. So ladies, 6 o'clock, please meet there. On Friday the 19th, obviously that's not this week, but the next Friday, we are having a bingo game. We are allowed to raise money with the bingo to pay for the chapel carpeting. And so we are starting the fundraising for that. And we start at 6 o'clock, from 6 to 8 o'clock. I happen to have the tickets here, and you can get them at coffee hour. It's $10 for adults, $5 for kids. It's a fun time. It's BYOB, and please bring a snack to share. There's a 50-50 drawing, and there are money prizes. So, hey, what's to lose? And it's a great and fun night. And now let us begin worship by listening to the introit.
Good morning, everyone. Please join me in the call to worship, which is found in your bulletin. We are the people of God, claimed by the Spirit. We are the body of Christ, fed by the bread of life, strengthened for the new year. Following God's star, seeing the holy in the ordinary, let us worship God. Now we'll sing the opening hymn, number 254, We Three Kings of Orient Are, verses 1, 2, and 5.
Mm-hmm.
be seated and join me in saying the prayer. Lord of all our days, we look forward to the beginning of another year with you and with each other. On this Sunday, when our church celebrates Epiphany, help us to be as persistent in our dedication as the wise men of old who sought out the Christ child. As you provided light for the wise men so long ago, shine your light to brighten our path. Give us your peace to ease our anxious moments, your love to heal our troubled minds, and your joy to rekindle our hope. Help us to remember that there is never a moment that you are not with us, that your Son is called Emmanuel, God with us. We pray in his name, Amen. And now together we will say the affirmation of faith. We believe in God, our source of hope, which though fragile and often dashed, is surprisingly strong and resilient. We believe that hope is given so that we can wake each morning with a sense of wonder and live each day in light of the joy that is promised. We believe that hope is woven with faith and love to form a tapestry of beauty and possibility. We believe that out of suffering and destruction can emerge something new, a new earth with the mark of God upon it. We believe our efforts make a difference and transform hope into bread for the hungry, clothes for the poor, and love for the forgotten. We believe the church is a community of hope, living the love of Jesus for all creation, continually renewed by the fresh wind of the Spirit.
Let us continue our worship by presenting our tithes, our gifts, and our offerings.
Thank you.
Let us pray. We thank you, O God, that you have blessed us with gifts beyond measure. We thank you especially for the gift of your Son, Jesus, who you sent to be our Savior. We bring these gifts to you today with grateful hearts. Use these gifts and use us for telling the glad news of your love to all the earth. We pray in the name of the baby of Bethlehem, Jesus our Savior. Amen. Please be seated. Today's scripture lesson comes from Matthew's gospel. Matthew, of course, tells the story of the wise men in the second chapter, and that's what we will be looking at this morning. So listen for God's word to you. Jesus was born in Bethlehem in Judea during the reign of King Herod. About that time, some wise men from eastern lands arrived in Jerusalem asking, "Where is the newborn king of the Jews? We saw his star in the east, and we have come to worship him." King Herod was greatly disturbed when he heard this, as was everyone in Jerusalem. He called a meeting of the leading priests and teachers of religious law and asked, "Where is the Messiah supposed to be born?" "In Bethlehem of Judea," they said, "for this is what the prophet wrote, 'And you, Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are not least among the ruling cities of Judah. For a ruler will come from you who will be the shepherd for my people Israel.'" Then Herod called for a private meeting with the wise men, and he learned from them the time when the star first appeared. Then he told them, "Go to Bethlehem and search carefully for the child. And when you find him, come back and tell me so that I can go and worship him too." After this interview, the wise men went their way, and the star they had seen in the east guided them to Bethlehem. It went ahead of them and stopped over the place where the child was. When they saw the star, they were filled with joy. They entered the house and saw the child with his mother Mary, and they bowed down and worshiped him. Then they opened their treasure chests and gave him gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. When it was time to leave, they returned to their own country by another route, for God had warned them in a dream not to return to Herod. This is the word of the Lord. Will you pray with me? O Lord, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. I think that the story of the Magi and King Herod and Epiphany grab human imaginations just as much as the Christmas Eve story and Easter stories. If you think about this story, it has all the ingredients of a thriller, a question that needs to be answered, a mystery, the promise of God that has to be protected, angel appearances, heroes, villains, and certainly an intriguing plot. There are also a lot of misconceptions about this story, some of which have come about by tradition, others by inference rather than by real information. For example, Matthew never calls the wise men kings. That idea seemed to creep in later as they looked through Old Testament prophecies. And even the number three wise men, is inferred because it mentions three gifts. There was a rumor that there was a fourth person, but because he wanted to bring a fruitcake, he was asked to stay home. I hate cute fruitcake. Traditionally, the names of the wise men are Caspar, no, not the friendly ghost, Melchior, and Balthazar. Garrison Keillor,
of Lake Wobegon fame still maintains that since they represent the Gentiles, one of them must have been a Lutheran who had a chicken noodle casserole with them. Of all the faces at the manger, the three wise men are the most alien and strange. Certainly, they're the only Gentiles there. And scholars surmise that they came from far away as Iraq. These men are also difficult to comprehend. After all, they traveled thousands of miles following an extraordinary light in the sky to see a king that is spoken of in some obscure prophecy in the Old Testament, and we never know if they're shocked that the king is not Herod Jr. at the palace in Jerusalem, but the child of a peasant couple, a poor peasant couple at that. And yet we don't get the feeling that they've been disappointed, because they present their gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh, and bow down and worship Jesus. I think it's that very mystery that tantalizes storytellers and hearers alike over the years. As far as the Gospel of Matthew is concerned, these individuals were quite educated, probably in various sciences, but most certainly in astrology, since of their familiarity with all the stars. Their role in the whole infant story of Jesus is definitely intriguing, far fuller and richer than the one of the simple shepherds who show up at the manger Christmas Eve, because the Magi here bring with them ancient prophecies and the foreshadowing of evil forces that threaten Jesus' life. So, the first part of this story leaves us with a growing suspense. Something big is happening on a cosmic level, something that concerns the whole world. But what is it? Then we come to the evil part of the story. Every drama, whether fictitious or in real life, seems to have a hero and a villain. Now, the hero in this story is obviously God, fulfilling a promise and trying to do something spectacular for human beings. The bad guy is obviously King Herod, inspired by the forces of darkness to quench the light of God. Herod is the ultimate villain. He exhibits four classic characteristics of a villain: a preoccupation with power, possessions, prestige, and of course, paranoia. First of all, Herod likes power. Herod is addicted to power. If power were an alcoholic beverage, Herod would have been passed out on the floor with having it. Herod uses his power to secure his destiny. Herod wiped out his enemies, terrorized the countryside, and used crafty diplomacy to get ahead. In fact, it's said that almost all of his 10 marriages were for political reasons. It seemed that he could just never get enough power. And to hold the power, he brutally removed anyone who got in his way. Over the years, he actually killed many people, even family members. He killed his brother-in-law, his mother-in-law, two of his sons, and one of his wives. He was an out-and-out killer. He murdered out of spite and killed to stay in power. Human life meant nothing to him. The great historian Josephus called him barbaric, and another writer called him a malevolent maniac. And if that wasn't enough, Herod was preoccupied with possessions. He wanted it all. He wanted as much as a Roman Caesar had, and then some. Herod was also occupied with prestige. He loved to make an impression on others. He built entire cities with state-of-the-art architecture and amenities. And of course, he was responsible for the great temple in Jerusalem. And finally, Herod was preoccupied with paranoia. After an enemy poisoned his father, Herod was beset with paranoia, maybe to good reason. He had secret passageways in all 10 of his fortresses. He also had an elaborate network of spies. Anyone who plotted to get him off the throne was snuffed out before they had breakfast. And anyone who wanted to get to him was probably dumped for a midnight swim in the Jordan River with a cement bathrobe. With this background in mind, let's fast forward to our scripture passage. A large entourage from the east shows up at Herod's palace. The Magi would have swept into Jerusalem with pomp and circumstance, and probably covered with dust. At a minimum, they would have brought a full military escort with them and their servants. No wonder all Jerusalem was buzzing. They were important enough to get an immediate audience with Herod. That wasn't easy to do. And they asked, "Where is the one who has been born king of the Jews? We want to worship him." Herod was instantly upset. He was the king of the Jews. He didn't get born to have that title. He had to kill to get that title and keep it. So what were these men talking about? Why didn't his spies pick up on this bit of intelligence about a boy king? Matthew 2:3 says that when Herod heard this, he was disturbed, and all Jerusalem with him. And no wonder. Herod thought that he had killed all of his enemies, and now these strangers come with a strange question. No time to rest now. One more person to kill, a young boy who claims to be king. And no wonder the Bible says that all of Jerusalem was shaken. No one knew what this wacko was going to do next. Herod only has one question in verse 4. Where will the child be born? In other words, where is this threat located? So he turns to the scribes and religious leaders for advice. The scribes don't even have to look it up. They already knew the answer. 700 years before, the prophet Micah had said that a Messiah would come from the town of Bethlehem. That was common knowledge in Israel. Little children learned that in Sabbath school when they were very young. So if you add what the scribes knew to what the wise men figured out with the star in the sky, you can conclude that the signs of Jesus' coming were clear enough for anyone to see. Friends, remember this. God always speaks loudly and clearly enough for a willing ear to hear. The wise men heard and did something. The religious scholars knew and did nothing. God always provides travel guides to earnest seekers. Those who seek diligently for Christ will eventually find him. Way back in Jeremiah, God said, "You will seek me and you will find me when you seek me with all your heart. I will be found by you." Anyone who thinks they can do this life under their own power soon realizes they can't. We need our Creator. We need a power beyond ourselves, not just to take care of us, but to give us direction. We need to seek the Lord Jesus. Everything we need is found in him. And like the wise men, we need to give him everything and worship him. The wise men were so overwhelmed with the Messiah, they gave him all that they had and all that they were. And they went home changed men. I'm not surprised. We've come today to worship the newborn king. So what do we offer God? How can we offer anything but everything. I'll close with one little story about a minister during the Advent season. His four children asked Dad to come down and be their audience for a Christmas play in the living room. The father saw the set as he came down the stairs. Baby Jesus was a flashlight wrapped in a blanket. I thought that was a good idea, by the way. Joseph had a bathrobe and a mop for a staff. Mary looked solemn with a sheet draped over her head. The angel of the Lord had pillowcase wings, and the one king carried another pillowcase filled with gifts. This king, who was the youngest of the bunch, had felt duty-bound to explain herself and her mission. She said, "I'm all three wise men, and I bring precious gifts, gold, circumstance, and mud." Well, the minister had to cover his face to not laugh out loud at that. But later on in his office, he reflected on those three gifts, gold, circumstance, and mud. And he thought that that would be a truly wise gift for the Christ child. Think about it. Our gold, the most common item of our enslavement. We spend so much time and energy to make money, to save money, to manage money, that it can easily become the total focus of our lives. Handing over our gold to God, then, becomes a symbol of our commitment to a different set of priorities and our circumstance. We're all different. We all exist amid a multitude of particular circumstances, sometimes good, sometimes bad, sometimes limiting, sometimes depressing, sometimes joyful, sometimes challenging. But I bet that none of us considers that our particular set of circumstances is the ideal or the embodiment of all the dreams and wishes we've ever had. There's always something that we would like to change about our circumstances. So instead of constantly wishing that we could have something different in our lives, consider offering God yourself today, just the way you are, whatever the circumstances are surrounding your life. Offer your circumstances and then let God direct your path. And finally, the little girl said her last gift was mud. That actually could be profound. None of us are heroes, and certainly none of us are King Herods. We're just ordinary people who, through day-to-day living, have gradually added enough dirt and grit to the clear waters of our lives to muddy them up into a mess. But we can take our mud to Jesus, so that we don't dirty our relationship with God. And rather, Jesus gives us fresh water for our lives, water to wash down that muddy nature and to get the flow of pure waters back into our souls. This morning, when you come to the table, consider bringing all that you are. Slow down enough to taste and see the goodness and grace of God. The elements you're going to get are certainly not going to fill your stomachs, because I hear complaints all the time about how little those wafers are. But having the opportunity to bring who you are and what you have, and remembering that you are being offered the bread of life and the cup of salvation, can get you back on the track of what is most important in life. Will you pray with me? Dear Lord, we just passed the holy day when we remember that you came to us to be one of us, to offer us new life in you. Well, Lord, we're back in the grind of days again that start to put that muddy water back in our lives. This morning, let us begin again Let us feel the cool, clean water you give us as we share the holy meal you offer. We pray in the King's name, our Lord Jesus. Amen. And now, if you'll stand and sing with me the communion hymn that's found in the bulletin. Remain standing, let us join together in the prayer of confession in the bulletin. Almighty God, unto whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Please be seated. My friends, this is the joyous feast of the people of God. The Bible tells us that they will come from north and south and east and west to join together at God's table in God's kingdom, where Jesus will be our host. This is a feast that has been prepared by Jesus' own body and blood. And he invites everyone to share in this feast if they believe in him and trust in him. You have been invited to partake of Christ's feast. At this time, the ushers will come forward and pass out the elements. If you're new to this process, when you get the little cup, there are two tabs. It's hard sometimes to find that first one. You pull the first tab for the wafer and the second tab for the juice that's beneath it. Jesus said, "I am the light of the world. Those who walk in darkness will never walk in darkness again, but have the light of life." There's a hymn that says, "The whole world was lost in the darkness of sin. The light of the world is Jesus. Like sunshine at noonday, his glory shone in. The light of the world is Jesus. Come to the light, 'tis shining for thee. Sweetly the light,
has dawned upon thee. Once I was blind, but now I can see. The light of the world is Jesus. Will you pray with me? Almighty God, it is truly right and our greatest joy to praise your name. By your majesty and power, you created all that is, making a universe out of chaos and ruling over all things in love. We thank you for revealing yourself to us by sending Jesus to us to be the light of the world. He came to heal our brokenness. He lived with us, sharing joy and sorrow. He told your story, healed the sick, and was a friend of sinners. Obeying you, he took up his cross and was killed by people he loved. We praise you that he is not dead, but is risen to rule the world. Remembering the Lord Jesus, we break bread and share this cup, announcing his death for the sins of the world and telling his resurrection to all people and nations. Gracious God, pour out your Holy Spirit upon us and upon these gifts of bread and wine, so that we may be drawn together and joined with Christ our Lord. May we receive new life and cool, clear water to remain his joyful and faithful people until we feast with him in glory. Through Christ, with Christ, in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor are yours, Almighty God, now and forever. Amen. The Bible tells us that on the night that Jesus was arrested, he took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Let us take that first tab and partake and eat in thanksgiving. And in the same way, after supper, Jesus took the cup. And when he had given thanks for it, he gave it to his disciples and said, "Drink this, all of you. This cup is the new covenant sealed in my blood, which is shed for you and for many for the remission of sins. Do this in remembrance of me." Let us drink and be thankful. The Apostle Paul reminds us that each time we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim the saving death of our risen Lord until he comes. These are God's gifts to us as God's beloved children. As we come to the prayer after communion, let me share with you some of the concerns of our congregation. We're continuing prayers for Dave McCann, Ken Heck, Patricia Zappone, Cynthia Mario, Neil Gamble, excuse me, Lexi and her family. We're praying for Carolyn, Athena, Don Green, Joanne DeJohn's friend Joanne, Sonia's niece, Roxanne, and her little girl, Nora. We're praying for Carol Zerbe's brother, Bob, Maria, Dylan, Catherine Sheeran, Gerald, Dana, Holly and Beth, Carl Ekstrom, who is at home, Judy Haverstick, and Linda Donovan's mother, Gladys, who is at Woodlawn in Mays Landing. Are there any other joys or concerns to share? Lynn? Pat, who's in the hospital. Let's join our hearts and minds in prayer. Let us pray. God, our Savior and Helper, we thank you for this meal shared in the Spirit with your Son, Jesus, who makes us new and strong. Almighty God, you hold the whole world in your hand. We continue to pray for peace in this world that seems more threatening every day. Let arms and bombs be turned into farm instruments, and may all people treat each other as brothers and sisters in your beloved family. We thank you for revealing Jesus to be your son and for claiming our lives in baptism to be his disciples. By your Spirit, may peace descend upon us. Be with those who need your help. You have already heard the prayer requests of our congregation. Hear now the concerns that cause us distress and anxiety that lie deeply in our hearts this morning. Grant us your peace. As we begin this new year, Lord, walk with us. Be our light, be our guide. Give us a new vision this morning. Let us hear again your words, "Fear not, I am with you always." Let us focus on all that you have given us and assure us that you will lead us and guide us to fulfill your plans for us. We pray all these things in the strong name of Jesus, who taught us all to pray, saying, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen." And now, if you'll turn to the insert in your bulletin, we have our last hymn, "As with Gladness Men of Old." We're singing the first three verses. I hope you'll join us for coffee hour in Fellowship Hall, and you can say Happy New Year to one another. May there always be stars to guide you and a smooth road to travel. May you find thousands of blessings each day. May God give you hope each morning and peace in the evening. And may God walk beside you now and always. Amen.